Donna spoke to us about God's forgiveness. Danny spoke to us about what forgiveness is and what forgiveness isn't. So today, I thought we'd focus on a practical forgiveness. Okay? So, I need you to be awake with me. We're going to read a parable from the Bible, and we're going to analyze the parable and see what we can gain out of it. Okay, so if you open up Matthew 18, and we're going to read from verses 21 to 35. Can someone read it for us? Malty?
18, 21.
It's on the screen if you can't remember. 18, 21, 35. Can someone read for us, Malty?
Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him? Up to seven times? Peter said unto him, I do not say to you, up to seven times, but up to 70 times seven. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. And when he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him, who owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, his master commanded that he be sold, with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, said, Master, have patience with me, I will pay you all. Then the master of the servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and prayed him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. And he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what had been done, they were very grieved and came and told their master all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all the debt because you begged me. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I have pity on you? And his master was angry, and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due to him. So my heavenly Father also will do to you if each of you, from his heart, does not forgive his brother his trespasses.
Cool. So, I'm sure we've heard this parable before, okay? But before we start, I just want you to forget everything you've ever heard about this parable, everything you've ever learned in church about this parable, and let's just start fresh. Okay? I think it's the first time we hear this, okay? So, just in case you weren't paying for attention, I'll just read the first verse again. Then Peter came to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Up to seven times. What do you guys think of Peter's question? What do you think of the way the question is structured? So he's basically asking, how many times shall I forgive my brother? Is seven times enough? And you all know that seven is like the complete number in the Bible. So he's basically saying to him, seven times enough, the maximum, the complete number. And I think in another gospel, Peter asks seven times a day. So every day, seven times, that's the maximum. Is that enough? What do you think of the question? Is it a good question, a bad question? Okay, very good. So it's counting how many mistakes. Very good. Do you guys remember what Danny spoke to us about what forgiveness is? What was forgiveness? Do you guys remember? What's forgiveness? What's the definition of forgiveness? Yeah, very good. So we said forgiveness is basically letting go of the wrong and keeping no account of it. So not keeping track of it. So by Peter saying, how many times can I forgive my brother? He's implying that he's going to start counting. So he's not going to forgive anything. So the question doesn't even make sense, does it? Because come the sixth time, Peter will be thinking, I forgive you, but you're all jets. That's not forgiveness. Because forgiveness should be no record. So forgiveness, and this is what God does with us. Every time we sin, it's not the first time. God doesn't keep a record and say, I'm going to forgive you X number of times. You got one more chance. And that's why it doesn't make sense when we ask, how many times is God going to forgive me? It's that same thing. Doesn't make sense. She doesn't understand what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is blank slate, start again. So I've seen 1,000 times, and I've seen 1,001 times. God will say, it's your first time. You see what I mean? So the question is, doesn't make sense. Counting how many times to forgive. But there's another issue with Peter's question, is that it's implying that he can do it himself. He's just saying, how many times shall I forgive my brother? Do you guys remember when the rich man came to Jesus and said, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Similar issue. He's just saying, I can do it. Tell me, I'll do it. But the issue is that forgiveness is not natural to us. Forgiveness is a divine act. It needs divine help. Right? So that's what's wrong with Peter's question. You can't do it, and you're counting. So Jesus answers by me. He says to him, I don't say to you after 7 times, but after 7 times 70. So I went to do 490 times. Now, can you count? Like, he's basically saying, like, you want to do numbers? All right, let's go. Like, 7, complete number times 70. You can't count here, like. You know what I mean? Stop counting, that's a thing. Okay? So then Jesus starts looking at a parable, a very interesting parable. I'll get to the parable quickly. So he says, therefore the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. Okay? And when he had begun settling accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. What's a talent? I'll get some Google research. Okay, so the parable talks about talents and denarius. Okay? I'll explain. So 10,000 talents equals 60 million denarii. Okay? Now, we all know from another parable that Jesus told us about the workers. Remember that the guy who found people idle on the market, and come and work in my field, and I'll pay you a denarii a day. So, one denarii, or denarius, is one day's wage. So this guy owes the master 60 million days of work. Okay? That means that if this guy was to pay back his master, he'd have to work 164,384 years of work, no weekends or public holidays, straight through. Just to give you an idea as to the magnitude of this guy's debt. Right? Now, I want you to think for a second. I'll say, let's think about this parable fresh. What is going on here? How did this guy accumulate such a debt? What's going on here? How did this come about for him to take so much money from his master, to owe the master so much money? His master must have been very kind, just kind of maybe ending, 10 times 7 accounts, that's his bill, right? And this guy must have been living it up. If you think about it, this guy has got what we took from his master for free, 164,000 years of work's wage. So he must be living it up. He must be living in a huge house, driving a Ferrari. He's like living life to the max on his master's account, right? So then the master says in verse 25, it says, but he was not able to pay, obviously. Too much money. He was not able to pay. So his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and the payment he made, right? So he had to come close to this debt. He's going to have to sold his pet, his wife, his children, everything. Just to come close to him, he's going to spend, you know, a few million on like holidays and stuff, so that'll be an awesome master, that at least he can recover, you know, some of it. So then the servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. What do you think of that? What do you guys think of what he said to his master? Is it true? He said, have patience, I'll pay you everything. seriously now, how you develop. So the first principle, get out of this parable, is that you can't pay the debt. And this is very, very hard for us to accept. But we have to get through our heads. It's a fact. We cannot pay the debt. No matter how hard you work, even if you live for 100 years, you're not going to pay the debt. Even if you live for 1,000 years and work every single day, you're not going to pay the debt. But this debt is beyond you. It's unpayable. Right? Now the issue is, we love to pay back debts. We just love it. We can't accept the fact that I can't pay debt. So you often hear people say, oh, I committed this huge sin, like, I feel so bad, so I feel like I have to do something. So either I'm going to help the poor, or I'm going to start serving, but I have to do something. Why? Because I'm doing what this guy's doing. Lord, I'll pay you back. Okay, just be patient. I'll pay you back, I promise. You can't pay back, you're tricking yourself. And the master knows that you can't pay back. Now, what am I talking about? You pay back what exactly? Because I'm not going to say that I'm wrong. But pay back what? Obviously, we must realize that God has given us so much, right? He's given us so much. In Corinthians, Paul says, and what do you have that you did not receive? So if you think about it, everything we have, we receive from God. Everything, even the breath in my nostrils, it's from God. My health, my life, everything. Can I stand up and say, this is mine? God, I did not receive this. I earned this. No, nothing. Because the fact that my own breath is not mine means that even if I think I earned something, your existence is not yours from the beginning. So that's number one. St. John Chrysostom says he's trying to answer this question about what did God do for us? What do we owe God? What then are God's good deeds? He asks. He created us from nothing. That's number one. As I said, our whole existence is His. He made the whole visible world for us. The heaven, the sea, the earth, animals, plants, the seeds. Then he goes, I must be grieved because of the infinite number of His works. So they say, I'm going to go on. You get the idea. Into us alone, of all that are on earth, He breathed a living soul. He planted a garden for us. He gave us a help in it. He gave us each other. And set us over all the brute species. And He crowned us with glory and honor. We're the only creature that God made on His image. And God gave us His image, His likeness. He breathed His breath into us. He invested a lot in us from nothing. And yet, after all this, when humanity turned out ungrateful towards its benefactor, He thought us worthy of even a greater gift, forgiveness. So on top of all that, so God gave me my life, my time, my talents, everything I own, He gave me. And then imagine God comes and says to you, I gave you all this. I gave you family, I gave you a brain, I gave you opportunities. What have you done with it? Have you worked for my profit? Don't forget all these things are mine. Remember the other parable when you're trying to lend a farm to some farmers and they think that it's theirs, but it's really his. And he wants wages now. And you can't stand up and say, Lord, I've wasted it. I'm sorry, I've wasted it in the dust. And then he says, I forgive you. So you see what I mean? That debt we can never repay. That forgiveness and all these gifts you can't accept. That's the best way to pay God back, if you like. There's a psalm, there's a verse in Psalms when David says, what shall I render to the Lord for all His benefits towards me? So he's asking this question, saying, how can I pay God back for everything He's done for me? You guys know what the next verse is? So he says, how can I pay Him back? And the next verse is, I will drink the cup of salvation. So that's not paying Him back now. You're basically saying, how can I pay Him back when I drink the cup of salvation? That's taking more from you. But that's the best way to pay God back, just accept it. Accept the gift. I've heard once on the air saying that, imagine your mom cooks an amazing meal for you. What's the best way to pay her back? Eat the meal. But the same thing with God. Imagine your mom cooks you a huge meal, and you're like, mom, what do I pay back? Eat the meal. How do I pay back? Maybe it's going to go. It's ridiculous. The best way to pay back is to eat the meal. Right? And that's the best way to pay God back. Okay, so we'll go on. Verse 20 says, I'll pay everything back, I promise. Master knows you're going to pay back. So, verse 27. Then the master of the servant was moved with compassion, released him, and forgave him the debt. Okay, this verse gives us the definition of forgiveness. Alright, look what happened. There are three things involved. Number one, the master moved with compassion. Number two, released him. Number three, forgave him the debt. Or in other words, cancelled the debt. Right? So forgiveness is made of three things. What value is it? Number one, it's a decision, it's a choice. So forgiveness is not an emotion, I feel forgiving, I don't feel that. It's a decision, I'm going to forgive. Okay, number one. Number two, I release him. It's very important. And we're going to focus back on that. You have forgiveness, the actual word for forgiveness in Greek. Where's my Bibles? What does the word forgiveness mean in Greek? Does that mean let go? Yeah? So I looked it up in the ancient Greek when the Bible was written. Forgiveness, to forgive means to just let go. Like, you know when this is a British phrase, you know when you say, allow me? I first heard this back here. I mean, like, allow me. But actually, that's the actual word for forgive, just allow it, leave it, let it go. Like, do you remember when Jesus went to John the Baptist to be baptized? And John was like, I can't baptize you. And Jesus said, permit it to be so, just allow it. It's the same word, forgive. Just leave it. Let it be, just leave it. Okay? So that's the second step in forgiveness. Choice, and I let it go, I leave it. And then I cancel the debt, like we said in the beginning. I keep no record of the debt, so it's cancelled. Clean slate. Okay, so you guys get it? They're the three steps.
Wait, what was the third one?
Clean slate. So you cancel the debt. You forgave the debt. So decision, let go, cancel the debt. That's forgiveness. That's what God does with us all the time. That's what we're asked to do with others. Now, just a few, I want to show you a few verses to show you how God does this with us. I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. So I think we spoke about this before. God chooses not to remember our sins. I think I told you a story before about a nun whose friend, another nun, passed away, and then she appeared to her. And then she appeared to her from heaven. And the nun was alive on earth and said to her, oh wow, what's heaven like? And she talked about heaven. And she said, when you go back up, can you just send a message to God? Tell him, I'm really, really sorry for that sin I committed. He'll know what I'm talking about. The one, just tell him, I'm really, really sorry. I just want to make sure that he knows that. So then she came back again to her a week later, and she asked her, did you tell God? And she said, yeah, I told him, but God says he doesn't remember what he was. But God chooses not to remember our sins. We choose to remember them, and the devil chooses to remember them as well. And the devil chooses to remind us of them, that God doesn't remember them. Right. And the good thing about this verse is that God says, I'm going to forgive your sins. Why? What's the reason? For my own sake. Not because you deserve it. Not because you're great. Not because your sins are that bad. I'll let it pass. No, I am forgiving for my own sake. So it's because of my nature, I'm forgiving God. So I'm helping with you. And this will help us when we start talking about forgiving myself. I don't deserve to be forgiven. I know you don't. That's not the point. He's not forgiving you because you deserve to be forgiven. He's forgiving you because he's forgiving you. You see what I'm saying? It's like the light bulb. Lights, not because you're good, because it's a light bulb. That's its nature. You can't affect it shining its light. You see what I'm saying? So it's for his own sake that he forgives our sins. Now the other funny thing about God, I'll show you this verse from Micah. Look at this verse. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in mercy. So the funny thing about God is that he actually likes to forgive. He delights in mercy. Whereas with us, forgiveness is a hard thing. If I need to forgive, I'm going to have to lose something. So I'm like, I have to force myself to forgive, and I hate it. But for God, it's the opposite. He loves to forgive. Which is funny. It doesn't make sense in our mind. But he loves to forgive. He loves for us to do things and cause losses, like he used to do anything, he loves to forgive. Like he's looking for a truth to forgive. Do you know what I mean? Whereas with us, it's the complete opposite. So that's what God does with us. Another beautiful verse is that from Psalms, very famous verse, "For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us." We spoke about this verse before. As high as the heavens from the earth, so great is his mercy toward us. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. So he's moved our transgressions away from us, just as far as the east is from the west. We've spoken about this before. How far is the east from the west? How far is it? In kilometers. If I say, okay, so I'm in England, if I head east, I'll be in Australia, okay? But then when I get to Australia, there's even more east, which is America. When I get to America, there's even more east. I keep going, I'm going to go around in circles forever. It's an infinite distance between east and west. And I heard my complaint saying, why did God say from north to south? Because he can actually reach again from the north pole to the south pole, it's a distance. But he didn't want to say that, he said east to west, that's infinite. Keep counting. Keep counting. That's how infinitely I've moved your sin away from you. So again, back to forgiving myself. When I say, I feel like I'm not forgiven yet, then you could basically call God a liar. He's moved it very far away from you, so far, infinitely far away from you. Another very nice verse. He will again have compassion. I remember I was once in Scotland with a woman, like I told you guys before. And I said to Aruna, how many times have I seen to Peter? How many times have God committed a sin and God forgive me? It's the exact same sin, daily, every day, and repent. Sin, repent, sin, repent. I've been sick of it myself. Surely God must be getting sick of it. So, you know what I mean? How do I look at that? And he showed me this verse, and he said to me, he will again have compassion on us. And he asked me, how many times is he going to have compassion on me? And I said, again. So he says, how many times is that? It's just again and again. Every time I read this verse, it's again. I read tomorrow, it's again. So again, it's never ending. He will have compassion on us and will subdue our iniquities. And then he says, he will cast all our sins into the depth of the sea. And as I told you before, to this day, human beings can go to the moon, we can do anything, but we can't go to the depth of the sea. Pressure out of us. So I think Jesus, God did that on purpose. He threw us into the depth of the sea, and he's going to make sure that no one can go to the depth of the sea again. So it's completely gone. So that's what God has done for us, in terms of forgiving us. It's a huge thing. I mean, we can speak about it all night, but I think unless we feel it, that's not going to mean it'll be good in theory. But we'll go on and you'll see the consequences. Let's go to verse 28. So the master, don't forget, had compassion on him, released him, and forgave him the debt. Now let's go. But that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. Okay, I'm going to go back. Remember the denarius? So he owed his master 60 million denarii. Okay. Then he found one of his mates who owes him 100 denarii. Remember, I told you it was 164,384 years of work with no holidays. That's how much he owed. His mate owed him 100 days worth of work. Okay, you see the comparison? Okay, so what does he do? He found a guy who owed him 100 denarii, and he laid his hands on him, took him by the throat, saying, "Pay me what you owe." Okay, now I want to think carefully about this. What is going through this guy's head? What could possibly be going through this guy's mind for him to do such a thing?
He didn't realize like the depth of forgiveness that...
He didn't realize the depth of forgiveness. Yes, very good. Okay, this is what I'm talking about, a more practical level in the story. What was he thinking? Okay, so let me go back a step. So remember, I said this guy's digging it up with his master's money. So he's got a lot of money from his master. Now this 100 denarii that he lent his mates, where did he get 100 denarii from? His master. So whose money is it? It's his master's, right? His master's forgetting. But he wants the money still from his friend. So what's he thinking? What is it? Exactly. So he's thinking, what if one day The master changes his mind, and only pay him back. Our best part collecting to have enough to pay back. Did you see for me? That's making possible to his head. Because if you think about it, imagine I'm standing here, and then someone comes to me and says to me, Bessie, you just won the lottery, man. You won £100 million. And then I go, hey, Danny, you owe me £10, man. Look at that. What are you going to say? I don't believe that I've won the lottery. I definitely don't, because if I believe that I've been running out cheering, I wouldn't even think of it, man. £10. So he chose this guy, didn't believe that his master would forget him. Didn't believe it. Because if he believed it, he would have said, man, you have no idea what's happening there. Don't worry about it. Keep it. Right? But the fact that he's holding on to this guy's throat, give me the money back, he doesn't believe his master forget him. Now, this is the key to this parable. The only way we're ever going to forgive others is if we believe that God forgave us. Like all those verses we saw, if that's a theory to us, fine, we'll look, we'll smile, that's very nice. We'll go, hey, you insulted me. And we won't forgive each other. But if I realize what just happened, and I believe that God actually forgave me all that debt, then I'll very easily forgive others. Do you understand? So my measure then of how much I believe God's love for me, or how much I believe God's forgiveness, is how easy do I forgive others. If I find it very hard to forgive others, then I don't believe God's forgiving me. So that's a test, to test ourselves. Make sense? Now, I was thinking, why don't we believe that God is leading us? Like, why is it so hard for us to believe that? What do you guys think? Any ideas? Why is it so hard for us to believe that?
Maybe we don't see it.
We don't see it. What do you mean?
Like, when, say, Moses the black, when he was forgiven, he saw a vision of God wiping, or an angel wiping his sins away. So maybe if we saw something like that, it would be more.
Okay.
So,
no, but then if we always saw that, we still would be like, oh, it's like normal. So you'd be like, what's the word I'm looking for? Immune to it. I just think the human nature doesn't let us forget. So we are always reminding ourselves of it, so we don't trust that God has really, like you said, God like forgets it.
We can't
forget either,
so God forgets. We don't forget. Yeah.
That's why we keep thinking, oh, he remembers too,
because
we put him in a human box.
Exactly. That's very good point. I was going to say that the way we're brought up, so you said human nature, our upbringing, the way we're brought up, we're always taught, right? You get what you deserve. Do you know what I mean? If you study hard, you'll get good marks. If you don't study, you'll fail. If you're a good boy, I'll give you chocolate. If you're a naughty boy, you don't get anything. Do you know what I mean? I heard a story about a girl. There was a counselor saying a story about a girl who came to see me. A woman, sorry. And she said that when she was young, her dad was very strict. Right? So she remembers very vividly that one Christmas, she got a toy that her parents got from overseas. Very, very big deal. And she was playing with it on Christmas Day, and she broke it. And her mum said to her, wait till your dad gets home. You're a big trouble. So the girl was so scared. Her dad came home, and the dad was a strict type of toy. And the dad was like, you know, rolling up his sleeve. He's like, get in your room. She knows what she's going to get. She's like, Dad, I'm sorry. He's like, get in your room. Dad, I promise. I'll fix it. He's like, get in your room. I'll pay you back. I'll save the money. I'll pay you back. He's like, get in your room. Imagine this girl goes to church and says, like, God is your father. He forgives you everything. Yeah, right. Seriously, it's no good? No way. So it's the way we're brought up, it's human nature which is taught. This equals this. Then God's mathematics comes out of nowhere, it's just weird mathematics to us. You know what? It's free. You earn this much, keep it. And you think you might just pay cash. There's no such thing as a free lunch, is there? There must be a cash. So God is always against our logic, against our upbringing, against the way of the world. And it's up to us, do we trust him or not? Another issue, I think, that stops us from... Actually, before I say it, any other ideas? Why else would we not believe that God is speaking to us?
I think we can forget, if I can't forget something, like in his infinite all-knowingness, he's just like saying, well, like it's not important anymore. He hasn't actually forgotten.
Yeah, again, we can pick up to us. So I was reading a book once, and I was basically like God speaking to someone, and God says to that person, it's so true, listen to this sentence. God says to him, when you think of me, you imagine the best state of yourself. And other people, goodness, and that's me. I am way above that. Because when I think of God, I think of me in my best state. Yeah, I'm pretty lovely sometimes. You know, I can forgive me. Other people, goodness, that's God. But no, God's like, a lot more than that. So I think our biggest issue is we can pick up to us. I think God's like us. God's human, like my dad. What do you mean by acknowledge it? You don't acknowledge it.
I don't know. I don't know. We just don't think it's real. Not real, but like it's not a reality.
You know, when they say if it's stupid to be true, usually it is. That's what we kind of think. Yeah.
As well, because I think if we did what we did to God to anyone else, or if we had it done back to us, we wouldn't forgive that person.
Yes, however, if you think of that parable...
Yeah, you're meant to.
No, if you think of that parable, who forgave him first? So the master forgave the servant first, and the servant believes that he forgave very easily. So that happens first. So God's already forgiven us. But our problem is, I think the key issue is, I don't believe God's forgiven. You know what I think? I think our relationship with God is the most important relationship in our life, and it reflects a lot of relationships. So if I fix things up with God, everything will fix with others. Do you know what I mean? But if I try to fix things with others, it's very hard because you can't please everyone and you're going to get lost. But fix things with God, that's everything will be. You'll know what to do with others. Do you know what I mean? But what was very easy answer, why else do you think we can't accept God's forgiveness? Put it up with that. I just can't accept it. Sorry? Okay, good. Yeah, what's the issue with that? Yeah, exactly. You said it. So, pride. Think about it. So, as I showed you the verse, God says, I forgive for my own sake, not for your own sake. Yes, you're bad. Yes, you don't deserve it. But I give it to you anyway. No. Like, I can't accept that. Yeah. Like, I broke something, I have to fix it. I have to pay it back. I can't be indebted anymore. Do you know what I'm saying? But I can't accept being indebted. I'll tell you a story. It's a true story, actually. I'll make it anonymous. There was a person who came from Egypt to visit their family overseas, right? Their family overseas was quite well off, but the family in Egypt was not that well off, and the Egyptian pound's very weak, you know how it is. So this person came with a lump of money for the holiday, spent for the holiday. And he basically said to the woman of the house, or his auntie, keep this money for me, right? And I'll take from you, I'll spend, and at the end, give me what's left over for me, right? So the auntie felt really bad. Egyptian pounds were even like, we were off, God's giving us. So what she did was, she kept the money, his money, but she gave him money from her pocket. And then at the end of the trip, she gave him back the whole money, like a whole amount. She goes, basically, don't worry about it, on me, here you go. That person got so upset, like so upset, that they went back to Egypt. And they called up crying and they made a big deal out of the whole family and they insisted to send the money back. You see, that's what we do with God. I can't bear to be in debt to God. I will fix it. If I made a mistake, I will fix it. You can't just tell me, okay, forget it, don't worry about it. I will pay you back. Do you see what I'm saying? It's easy, like, right? But this is very tricky pride because it comes in a very holy exterior. So it comes in, I'm a sinner, I'm really bad, I've got to serve, how can I pay back God? And it looks very holy, but the depth of it is pride. I can't accept to be given something for free, right? Am I a beggar? Do you know what I mean? No, I have to pay for everything, I have to feel the burden of everything. You can't give something for free. And that's where the idea of, I can't think of myself, comes from. I can't think of myself. But God's forgiven you. Okay, I'm not going to do this well. Do you see what I'm talking about? Pride in me that has to fix it. I can't beg someone else to fix it for me. You following me? Look at this quote from C.S. Lewis. It says, I think that if God forgives us, we must forgive ourselves. Otherwise, it is almost like setting up ourselves as a higher tribunal than him. So we're saying to God, you know what I'm talking about? I'll judge this. This sin should not be forgiven. You know what I'm talking about? The sin I've committed should not be forgiven. It's what a stupid thing to do, but think about it. You're condemning yourself, basically. This, my sin should not be forgiven. And that's what, when we don't forgive others, it's all the same thing. Like, for me, he say, annoys me, and I say, I'm never going to forgive you. I'm basically saying that that sin should never be forgiven. So if I forgive that sin, I'm never going to forgive you. See what I'm saying? That's what Jesus says. If you don't forgive, you're not forgiven. It's not like God's going to get you back for not forgiving. That's just the consequence of it. You're condemning yourself. You're saying this sin should not be forgiven. Then that's it. You're not going to be forgiven. Like, you've made the judgment. You see what I'm saying? So it's not God saying, you better forgive or else. No. He's missing this. Here's the consequences. If you don't forgive, you're not going to be forgiven. Right? Because you've already made the decision that you don't want to be forgiven. You see what I'm saying? Does that make sense? Okay, so let's go with the parable. Verse 29. So after he says to his mate, pay me what you owe. Verse 29. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. The exact same words that he used with the master, his mate used with him. Right? That same sentence. But what does he do? Verse 30. But he would not. Okay. Now remember, we spoke about the definition of forgiveness. It was a choice, letting go, cancelling the debt. Listen to this verse, but this is the opposite. This is unforgiveness. In the real translation, it says he was not willing. So again, it's the choice. I don't want to forgive you. Number one. The second thing, okay, so he would not, but went and threw him into prison. So the opposite was let him go. He threw him to prison. Okay? And the third thing, remember, God with us lets it go and cancels the debt. The third thing, threw him into prison so he should pay the debt. I'm not cancelling nothing. I'm counting every cent. Did you see the opposite? That's unforgiveness. A choice not to forgive, capturing that person, and waiting to be paid back every cent. Now, the issue with this is very important. The issue with this is that, imagine Mickey or someone upsets me, and I get really annoyed, and I say, I'm never going to forgive you, Mickey. Right? Who's annoyed more, me or Mickey? Like, Mickey's going to go live in his life, I'm not there. Who's burning, who's like boiling from inside? Who's feeling bitterness? Me or Mickey? It's me, right? So who's suffering? It's me. So we think that if I forgive someone, I'm not punishing them. No, you're punishing yourself. And when the parable says that you threw him into prison, really think about it, where's the prison? When I choose not to forgive someone, I throw them into prison. So Mickey annoys me, and I'm not going to forgive him, so I throw him into prison. Where's the prison? Is Mickey really in prison? Where's the prison? It's inside me, isn't it? So I've created a prison inside me and put him inside. You're not going to get out. Who's suffering? Imagine having a prisoner in your bedroom 24 hours a day. That's annoying. Thing. That's my work. You know what I mean? But we would like to keep them in there. And the person's there, but the person's not feeling anything. So you can have someone upset with someone for years, and the other person has no idea. And then years later, they go, you know what, you upset me, and I've been carrying it all these years. And the other guy's loving life, and enjoying life, and we're burning from inside. Burning. That's the prison. So forgiveness, when I say that forgiveness, the real word in Greek means to let go. It means release this person from the prison inside you. It's not doing you any good. Just release them for your own good. So when God tells us to do things, He's not telling us to be annoying, He's telling us because it's for our own good, it's for our own sake. Forgiveness is for me, not for the other person. That's a very important principle. Forgiveness is for my benefit, not for the other person. So let's see what happens. In verse 31, so when his fellow, and by the way, sorry, one more thing. So threw him into prison and waited for him to pay back all the debt would have been paid. Like, no matter how long you keep a person in prison, their debt's not going to be paid. So if you want to forgive, torture is going to torture you. Until you pay back every cent. Until you feel that you've been forgiven with your debt, you're going to be tortured. You see the limit? Is that making sense, or am I just... Yeah, any questions? Is that clear? Okay. Listen back to the last verse. So after he finished the parable, Jesus said, "So my heavenly Father also will do to you, delivering to the torturers, if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses." From your heart. Remember what I said? That the prison is in your heart, and forgiveness means to let go. So Jesus is saying, if you don't let go from your heart this person, that's what's going to happen to you. Make sense? So I guess, if there's someone you haven't forgiven, and as I said, it's hard. It's not easy. It's not in our nature to forgive. But think about this for a bit. Who's been tortured? You know, you've put this person in prison, and you've sentenced them, but it's all inside you. Like, nothing's actually happening. God's calling us to just let this person go. Just let the person go. And you will feel a lot better. And if you can't let it go, think. Do I realize how much I've been forgiven? Because as I said, that could be an indication of me not believing that God's forgiven me. I just don't believe it. That's why I'm holding on to every penny. Okay, just to finish up then, because as I was saying, it's not easy and it's hard. What if I can't forgive? It hurts so much what's happened. I find it very hard to forgive. What do I do? But I just can't. I want to, so the choice is there. You know, I said three steps. The choice is there, but I just can't.
You know, it says in 31, the servants, they were really outraged.
Yeah.
So we're talking about then, like when someone's outraged, that feeling is, you know, I can't forgive, I can't do it. It says straight away they went and told their master. Does that mean, like, for me that's like, I pray. Like, I can't deal with it, I can't forgive this person, so I had to turn to my master.
That's a great point, though. That's a great point. Okay, this is a great point. Think about it. The master was pretty upset with this guy. Firstly, he was upset because he didn't forgive, fine. But if you think about it, let's think about it very, very logically and practically in the situation. Sorry. Okay, so these guys are servants or slaves, right? They belong to the master, right? So me and Benny are slaves, we belong to the master. So the master is our owner, okay? If I get upset with Benny, who am I? Just up to, just there. Who am I? So we're both slaves. Who am I to say to Benjamin, you go to jail? Look, who sends the slaves to jail? Their master. The master's the owner. So for me to say to Benjamin, you're going to jail, I've sentenced you, I'm taking the place of the master. You see what I'm saying? So the master's basically saying to him, who do you think you are, man? You should have come to me, like I said, you should have come to me and told me that I'm the owner here, I'm the judge between you. Really?
Your initial reaction isn't, oh, I forgive you, it's, I feel hurt. What you're trying to say is, you should jump the feeling hurt part and, like...
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that instead of you sentencing them for the hurt, you go to the owner, to the master, and you say, he hurt me. You see what I'm saying?
Well, what's that going to do?
What's that going to do? Any ideas? What's that going to do? If I go to God, it's going to tell me.
Thanks for having me. Does that help?
It doesn't.
It doesn't.
Because we remember.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is... Okay, let me give you an example. I think we sometimes mix things up. We think that if someone hurt me, right, the only way to fix that hurt is for them to fix it. They can't fix it. If I'm walking down the street, and a taxi runs me over and breaks my leg, do I go to the taxi driver, fix my leg? What do I do? I go to the hospital, don't I? I can't expect the taxi driver to fix my leg. The hospital fix my leg. See what I'm saying?
So the consequence of that is I can't walk now.
True, but what I'm saying, if we want to fix the hurt, we go to the healer, fix it. The person really can't fix it. But we in our stubbornness, we can't help but grab the person by the leg, fix it. So it's me fighting with the taxi driver, I'm saying, fix my leg! Fix my leg! Go to the hospital, buddy. Yeah.
Sorry to be difficult, no. But forgiveness only comes after repentance, right?
Okay, go on.
So, what happens with me is not always necessarily the hurt part, because I can sort of brush that away, I think, quite easily. It's the feeling that, like they don't care. Like, they're not sorry.
Yes, okay.
And even if I am not that bothered, if they're not bothered to come and like apologise or something, then that agrees with me more than the thing that was.
That's very clear. Just one of the points, this is a perfect point you made. Who's suffering here? This is a perfect example. Who's suffering? It's a very new kid. I'm the one burning. But for your own good, you have to let them go. Don't keep them surviving. You see what I'm saying? I know it's counterintuitive to think about it. It's a funny way we think. We think by me keeping them in there, and I feel better. I actually make myself feel worse, but I like feeling worse. And someone says to you, let it go to feel better. No! I want to feel better. Do you know what I'm saying? Again, it's counterintuitive. And I say it's not natural to us. But all I'm trying to do tonight is to open up your eyes to another side. And maybe it's better for you to forgive than not to forgive. You see what I'm saying? Just want to wake them up.
Yeah, but I'd forgive, but if they asked, but if they don't want it, then they don't want to be forgiven, so...
Yeah, get there, you know, what I'm trying to say is that forgiveness is all about me, not them. Get there from now. I'm burning, I'm being tortured, I need to feel better, I've got to release a chance of resolution. Leave it. It's, and if something's hurting you, let it out. Don't keep it, but we love to keep it. Do you know what I mean?
That's my problem.
I think my problem isn't... Like, isn't necessarily what you were talking about. My problem is that I don't want to let it go. Like, I like feeling anger and hatred towards the person I'm angry with. I don't know if anyone else can relate, but like, when I'm angry with someone, I want to fuel it. Like, I want to sit with people that hate this person. I want to have conversations about this person.
It's
just, I want to just put oil into the
fire.
That's what I really struggle with.
If you think about logic in a second, is what we're doing making any sense?
Yeah.
No.
Donna.
I was thinking back when we had the series on emotional healthy spirituality, and one part was about pain. And I think that's in line with forgiveness. We want to hold on to pain like my friends. Oh,
sorry?
Can you give it a mic?
Sorry.
Thank you, Mary.
So I was just saying, a few months ago we had the emotional healthy spirituality series. We had a segment on pain, and we were talking about how to let go of that pain. I think like what Michael was saying, he wants to hold on to that. We don't want resentment. We don't want to let go, because in letting go, we're justifying the other person. So I think like what you're saying, it's about forgiving from within. And I think when I mentioned this before as well, a couple weeks ago, I'm trying to rephrase it, but. When Mandela left the prison after 26 years, does anyone remember that quote? He said, if I don't forgive those who betray me or those who imprison me, I'll still be in prison. So I feel like we have to remind ourselves it's just about us releasing ourselves from that kind of hatred and that.
Exactly.
Just a thing that's what I'm trying to say.
I'm saying that the other person can never heal you. We think that if they say sorry long enough, they're going to feel better. No, the devil will be paying for us. It's happening. They can't heal you. The taxi has run me over. Go to the hospital. Stop wasting time. Grab the taxi guy. I can't make it today. Let it go. Secondly, don't expect the other person to fix your hurt. Only the doctor can fix your hurt, not the other person. So go to the doctor, complain to him about the hurt, not to the other person. Okay, remember the flexion point. Now, to Louis' point, what happens if I flex? I can't. It hurts. I can't. I want to, but I can't. So I've got the first step. I've made a choice. I want to think, but I can't. Very easy, very Sunday school answer, but very powerful. Just ask. If you think about it, I was thinking about the life of Jesus and the suffering of Jesus. Do you know that Jesus experienced every kind of hurts known to human beings? But I was trying to think of one type of hurt that I've experienced that he doesn't know anything about. Do you know what I mean? That he can't sympathize with. So I've made a list here, right? So if, no matter how much I've been hurt, how I've been hurt, he's felt it more. So when we go to him and say to him, Lord, you felt what I'm feeling about times a billion, and you still forgave them, then how do you that? Give me some of that power. Do you think he's going to say, nah, good luck to you. Try your best. Of course he's going to. See what I mean? So we have to go to him. So let's think about the types of things that hurt us that we can't forgive. Did someone despise you? Check. He felt that. Despised. Rejected? Despised and rejected. Check. He's felt that. Did you ever feel forsaken by anyone? Parents or anything? He was forsaken by everyone. All those thousands of people he fed, all the people he healed, when the cross came, he's alone. Forsaken. Do you ever feel lonely? Check. He's felt it as well. There's nothing you felt that he's going to say, oh, I wish you. Everything you felt, he's felt. So when you go to him, he can sympathize and he'll be able to help you. Like St. Paul said, ever been betrayed? Ever felt stabbed in the back? Check. One of his best friends, his closest friends, stabbed in the back for money. Right? Have you ever felt unfairly treated? Life's not fair, it's not fair what's going on? Check. Right? Very unfair. His trial was the most unfair trial ever in history. The only trial where the ruler pronounces him innocent and he still gets crucified. Right? Very unfair. Unfair treatment. Have you felt disrespected? Insulted? Check. See what I mean? Think of any hurt that you felt that he hasn't. Ever felt humiliated? Really humiliated? Check. Just felt that. Let's go to the physical community all day. Have you ever been physically abused? Check. Ever been hit? Ever been spat on? Check. Ever been bruised? Cut? Have they cut you? Pierced you? Check. Stabbed you? Check. See what I mean? Have you ever felt tired? Ever felt worn out? Thirsty? Hungry? Cold? Check, check, check. See what I mean? So everything, any hurt will ever go through, he's felt. Ever felt exposed? Ever felt someone's exposed you in public? Check. Forever and for the whole world, he's naked on the cross. The criminal. You see what I mean? So I think Jesus chose this type of death and this era with the Romans and set everything perfectly so that he can feel every single hurt or pain that we'll ever feel. So that when we go to him, he can give us some of that power. And after all that, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And after all that, he still dies for them. But as they're nailing his hands to the cross, he's dying for them. You see what I mean? So that power, we should have access to, or else Christianity is a bit of a fake, you know, organization. It's either Jesus came to give us all these things, or give us the power, or it's just a waste of time, isn't it? So I guess, just to summarize, we've gone through the parable. If I feel God's forgiveness to me, I'll be able to forgive others very easily. Because what I've been forgiven compared to what they're doing to me is nothing. Forgiveness is for my own good, not for the other person. Forgiveness means to release that person. Decide, release, and no more account of sin. And finally, as you said, you can't fix it. So they can't fix it. Only the doctor can fix it. So go to the doctor, and as we just said now, even if you find it hard, go to him, ask him to give you some of that power that he used to forgive others. Thank you. Any comments, questions?